Hey everybody, welcome to Greasy Time. Simo, welcome to episode 5, I think, at this point, and welcome to the show. We got Mr. Slim Hopper welcoming you to the show. You know, he's a king bee, and he knows what's good for you. So anyway, I hope you all having a good week. I sure am. Kind of a weird week here in Nashville. Had another big storm come through, and didn't have power for a while, and I didn't know if I was going to be able to do the show tonight, actually, because it's a big long story, but I guess we they're gonna have to cut the power off for an undetermined amount of time to be able to repair some of the damage still from the storms last week. So man, 2020 be kicking our butt, man. So but nonetheless, I'm really happy to be here. Thank you for tuning in, and again, thank you all for just all the messages, all the comments, the shares, the likes, all that kind of stuff. It just really means a lot. It's fun for me to sort of work on the show over the course of the week, and sort of use the viewer, your questions and comments and stuff like that as sort of a way to kind of do it. So as a result of that, I'm going to introduce two new sections of the show, because I get a lot of the same kind of comments or questions or, you know, direct messages, emails and stuff like that. So I'm going to compile them and sort of put them into two new segments of the show that I'll always do at the top of the show here. So the first segment is a segment I like to call Record of the Week. And what I'm going to do with the Record of the Week is, or Records of the Week, sorry, I already screwed it up. So what I'm going to do is basically take 5 of the records that I'm listening to a lot that particular week, and tell you what they are, and tell you a little bit about them. And if you want to go check them out, you can. So the first record, my first record of the week is this record right here, which is a record called Condoro el Mundo, which is a record by Krongbin. And if you aren't familiar with Krongbin, get hip, because they're from Houston. They're this amazing instrumental trio, sort of Afro soul, Middle Eastern, sort of Thai funk, breakbeat, psychedelic, just incredible band. I'm a really big fan. The guitar player is really brilliant. His name's Mark Spear, and just a really great player, very unlike most that are out there right now. Just the way he plays, he's very influenced by African guitar players, as well as, you know, all the same R&B and soul guys that I love, and psychedelic stuff as well. The bass player, Laura Lee, oh my God. I mean, she, not only is she absolutely drop dead gorgeous, but she is a monster player, man. I mean, just, you know, flat wounds and heavy groove, and oh, they're so good. So that's the first record of the week. Check it out. Obviously, it's on Spotify, Apple Music, all that. Second record of the week is this right here. This is a record called Funky Skull, which is, I was actually looking for records by Little Son Jackson, the old school blues guy. And this guy was also named Little Son Jackson. Melvin Johnson was his name. Funky Skull is a record I found of his, and basically he's like an upright jazz bassist that's playing his upright through fuzz tones and wah-wah pedals over sort of JB's-esque grooves just from the late 60s or early 70s. This is just a fantastic record. I've turned a lot of people onto this record. I was listening to it a lot this week, and I beyond highly recommend it. This next record, I talked a couple of weeks ago about a lot of the Accello guys. That Accello was the Louisiana kind of counterpoint to Sun Records in Memphis, or Chess, or VJ, or Cobra in Chicago. This is just a really good collection. It's on Spotify and Apple Music. And not only does it feature the guys that I told you about, Little Slim Harpo and Lightning Slim and Lazy Lester, but this also has like really obscure stuff, like Guitar Gable in particular is one of, I love Guitar Gable. So check this out. This is really good. A very obscure, really good stuff. This next record is a record by my buddy Kelly Finnegan up in San Francisco. He has an amazing horn band called the Monophonics. This is his solo record, The Tales People Tell. This is an amazing record, and Kelly is, I actually met him on a cruise. We were playing on this cruise, and when we met, it was like I felt he and I both individually felt a little out of place somewhat, from some of, not all, but some of the other acts that we were around. And when we met, we just took to each other really well, and I just fell in love with the Monophonics, and he's become a good buddy. And you know, basically, you know, this is sort of the West Coast version of what's going on right now, sort of like, you know, Daptone over on the East Coast has been happening for, you know, 15 years, 20 years now, geez. This is sort of, you know, Kelly is kind of one of the many that's kind of killing it out on the West Coast up in San Francisco. This record's out on Coal Mine, which is another label that, if you aren't hip to Coal Mine Records, get hip to Coal Mine. They also have the Delman Lamar organ trio. If y'all are hip to them, I love them a lot. They're part of the Coal Mine family. It's just another label, sort of like Daptone, that it's like, if you dig one thing, you're going to dig everything on the label. And anyway, this record is just really great, and it's taken me a minute to get to it. But this next record is my favorite of the week. This is Pastor T.L. Barrett and the Youth for Christ Choir. This is in Chicago in the late 60s. A record called Like a Ship Without a Sail. And my good buddy Michael Zimmerman, funky, awesome bass player here in Nashville, good buddy. He turned me on to this record. This is a ridiculous, funky record. It's got a hell of a vibe. You got to listen to it. This is a really great record. And the great Phil Upchurch is playing bass on it, and it's the reason why he was so prominent in that era, especially on recordings made in Chicago. Curtis Mayfield and stuff like that. It's just great, 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 great record. So there you go. There's the top five records of the week for this week. And this next section, I get tons and tons of gear-related questions, and I tried to cover a lot last week, but also things kind of change from week to week, and I try different stuff out, and I might be digging some more than others. So I'm going to do this section every week called Rig of the Week. And actually, that's the rig of the week. I posted a picture yesterday. A lot of people liked it on Instagram and Facebook. I'm really into these Ampegs, Ampeg Gemini 1 and Gemini 2s. I've got one of each, and they're both fantastic. And I just really dig them. And also, that Jax Fuzz Wah, I love that thing. It's I did cheat. I put a better pod in it. And made it an even better wah-wah. But man, is it great. It just does what I want. It's a funky old school kind of sound. And then of course Red, my dear old 335, which actually I've had some problems with this week. I don't know if you guys can notice, but there's a brand new tailpiece on this right now. This is not going to stay on here. I have one coming to me. From Pigtail, which is I love Pigtail's sort of studs, tailpieces, bridges, and stuff like that. They really sound good as far as like old Gibsons and stuff like that, and also like saddles. This is getting me through because apparently I had sweated and corroded the original tailpiece so much that this guitar no longer could be grounded. I thought that the wires had come undone, and my dear friend Joe Glazier, who's a wizard here in Nashville, and also Kevin down at Carter Vintage have spent time trying to figure this out, and then finally Kevin figured it out today that this in fact that I'd corroded it, and that's what was causing it to buzz. There's a saying that I've heard a million times in my life, and the saying is, that's not normal, or that's the first time I've ever seen that. Things of that nature, I'm very used to that. They call me the beta tester, with good reason. Things that should not go wrong will go wrong with me. And it's not because I'm doing anything in particular. It's just like if you hand me your guitar or I play through your amp or something like that, it's just look out. So I've got that on there so I can still record and stuff like that and not be buzzing like crazy. And also I've gotten a ton of questions about the pick guard. So let me take care of that. So a few years ago, I lost the screw over in Europe somewhere, so I took the pickguard off. The pickguard remained off because we were busy, we were gone constantly, and it's just something I didn't really think about. I guess it was about a year ago, Joe Glazier here in Nashville was like, man, you know, you should really put the pickguard back out, because I've actually worn like a big divot right here where I'm wearing a hole through the top of the guitar. And he's like, you know, you're still young and you know, you should take care of that guitar, put that pickguard back on. So he put it back on. He's like, I'll give you a screw. So he put it back on. It was in getting something done to it. And when I got it back, it had it back on. So I played it for a few days, but I found that I'd gotten used to my hand being down on the wood and it was kind of in my way. So I took it back off. And Glazier has continued to kind of make fun of me about it just minorly in his way and some other people since the COVID pandemic started I'd never cleaned this guitar ever And I always had that sort of, you know, it's the funk is in the grime and all that kind of stuff. And man, I just was like, you know, I love that guitar, and I feel like that's kind of a young man's sentiment, you know, getting beat up jeans or something like that. That's kind of a kid thing. And I was like, you know, I'm gonna put the pickguard back on and get used to it being back on so that I can take better care of it. And then I actually did clean it for the first time ever. And it actually sounded better, and I was able to intonate it properly and all this stuff. And so it's just a way of just changing, just evolving, you know, take care of your stuff, you know, there's no reason not to. So so that's the thing about that. So moving on with the show, y'all with me so far? So, bunch of questions that I want to address from that carry over from last week before I start talking about the stuff I want to talk about today, which the topic for today is people I can't believe I haven't talked about yet, that are important to me and I just haven't gotten around to. So, quickly, got a lot of questions about miking techniques, and so that I could talk for hours, okay? But at least for me, personally, the only thing that I'll say blanketed is I don't like to put microphones right up against the grow cloth. I don't like the way that sounds. I don't like the way that that records. And even live, I don't really like that. I understand why people do it, and I understand that that's the right way. But even live recordings that I really love, like if you watch that old Beat Club footage of Freddie King or any number of things, you know, the microphone's a little bit away from it. So I typically mic stuff at least a foot or two away and sort of move it around until it sounds good. And live, I just pull it away a little bit so that it's sort of a compromise. So it's not right on it, but it's like maybe a foot off. I just think it sounds better. It gives the wave more time to develop, and it doesn't sound so tinny or whatever. I've tried lots of different microphones. I don't necessarily have a preference at the moment for what I've been recording, all this old school R&B stuff and all that. I've actually, I'm just back to using a 57. I don't think you can beat it. The Cascade Fathead is fantastic. That's a ribbon that's really, when I was using the Marshalls, back when I was using really loud amps, those things were great. You couldn't kill them, and they sound fantastic. So that's kind of that, you know. The next question is about big amps in particular, and I get a lot of questions of, do I miss the Marshalls? No, I don't miss the Marshalls. That's why I don't use them. I had a lot of fun with them, and got that big 60s... rock, you know, Clapton, Allman Brothers kind of sound. But that's just not where my heart or my head is at the moment. You know, I'm into much cleaner things and more R&B inspired and more fuzz driven. I love it. It's great. And who knows? I might try it again at some point. I might incorporate it a different way. But the reason that I changed in the first place, the reason I stopped using the Marshalls was because I just felt like I was really being boxed in by a look and a sound, and I wanted to try and be more open, and I wanted to see what would happen if I changed drastically. How that would feel, and how it felt was I ended up becoming a lot more creative, and therefore a lot happier. So I've just kind of continued with it and just kind of continued growing. Everybody goes through different phases, you know. But it was really fun. As far as big amps, recording big amps generally don't record as well as small amps. You got to back the microphone even farther away. You know, the best results I ever had were a few feet away, not necessarily even aimed at a cone. Sometimes like a 412, like just right and I know this sounds crazy, but like pointed right at the center, like in between the four speakers. Bill Halverson, the guy who engineered Wheels of Fire for Cream, as well as a million other really great things. That's actually how he mic'd Eric's Marshall for like Crossroads and all that kind of stuff on Wheels of Fire. So I tried it, and he just used an old Unidyne, which is a 57 essentially, and he said it was just he kept moving it around until he liked the way it sounded, and he said when he realized it, he said it was just in the middle of the four, pointed in the middle of the four speakers. So that's something you can try. And it's obviously a lot darker and not really suited if you're in a bigger band, but if you're in a trio or something like that, then great. So then sort of cleaner, got a lot of questions about like the amount of gain or amount of distortion or something. For me, I think cleaner is better. I think that even like on really distorted records, like whether it be a Hendrix record or a Zeppelin record or, even like, it's not really my bag, but like AC/DC and stuff, that stuff is way cleaner than you think it is. Typically gain and compression and all that kind of stuff, like the more it is, kind of the less it sounds better on tape generally. I mean, I'm making very wide statements. Don't give me hate mail or anything. But generally cleaner translates better, just slightly cleaner than you think. I do have a little tip that I want to pass on, because I've had a lot of people asking about how to optimize Fender amps, like if you play through a Princeton or a Deluxe Reverb or a Super Reverb or a Vibrolux or something. Any that have two channels where like one channel is no reverb or trim and the other channel is reverb and trim. When you look at the back of the amplifier, the very first tube is a tube called V1, okay? And it's a 12AX7. And if you literally just pull that tube out, just pull it out, okay? You're immediately going to get a little bit softer, a little bit more compression, and a slight gain bump in the reverb tremolo position. Essentially, you're taking the tube out of the normal channel that you aren't using normally. You don't need it, and it's not going to do you any harm. And Freddie King used to do that, apparently, and I've been doing it forever. Whether it's my amplifier or like if I'm on a fly date where we're using backline gear or something, I just always go back right back there and pull it, and it just makes the amp sound better. So I wanted to share that. That's a nice little easy hack that, you know, you can use. And then the other thing is a lot of people ask me about reverb and trim, like pedals and stuff like that. I'm not the right guy to ask. I personally think that there are some pedals that sound decent, but I think just get a great amp that has a great reverb or tremolo in it and use that. I personally, in particular reverb pedals, I've never heard one that I think sounds great. I've heard a lot. Just nothing sounds like an amp. Just get one with an amp in it. And then the last one is just about like getting away with playing loud. And here's what I'll say about that. I do play loud, not as loud as I used to be by far. And now, even now that I'm into the Ampegs, I'm even coming down even more so. So I think it's about getting an appropriate sized amp and then turning it up. Because like a Princeton or a Deluxe Reverb or something like that are pretty usable in most any musical situation, and I think both of those size amps are, and those amps in particular, are just fantastic to get the job done. And you can turn them up and not be offensive, you know. If you're never going to have the opportunity to be in a situation where a 40 or a 50 watt or a 100 watt for that matter amp is, if it's always going to be too loud, then just you know, simply don't get it or get rid of it. I'm actually kind of shedding some stuff of mine at the moment, just because I'm kind of digging, kind of coming down a little bit and using the Ampegs, and it's, you know, it's cool. So, so that's kind of, that's that. That's, the last of, you know, thank you again for all the questions from last week. I'm glad everybody seemed to enjoy it. I'm going to change guitars because I'm going to talk about a few guys. Y'all with me? Have I lost you? I know I've been talking and haven't been playing, but I promise I'm going to play now. So the first guy that I want to talk about that I haven't is this guy right here, the guy on the left. That's Pop Staples. And Pops is one of my favorites. I love the Staples singers, okay? Just love them. And listen to them all the time. It's part of my normal listening. And Pops in particular is a, again, kind of a overlooked hero when it comes to the guitar. That's him, incidentally, in Muscle Shoals, where they recorded their biggest hits, I'll Take You There and Respect Yourself. And actually, no, I don't think they did Respect Yourself. They did that in Memphis, but definitely I'll Take You There is from Muscle Shoals. But that's him with the great David Hood, one of the most recorded famous bass players in the history of music. But anyway, Pops, you know, he's from Mississippi, and he actually grew up knowing guys like Charlie Patton and Robert Johnson and Sonhouse. Had incredible stories about growing up and knowing those guys. And the Staples Singers as a group started making records in the 50s for VJ in Chicago, which is the same label that had Jimmy Reed and had John Lee Hooker. And incidentally also had the Beatles' first album, because the Beatles couldn't get a record deal here. So VJ did quite well on that. But incidentally, Pops, he had just a real funky style that is often imitated, especially in the Americana field currently. He liked to use, you know, amps with reverb and tremolo, and usually Fenders, but he called tremolo or vibrato shake. He said, give me some with some shake on it, like that. And he tuned down a lot. Kind of like Sister Rosetta Thorpe, okay? And played with his fingers a lot, you know, played with a thumb pick a lot. Funky style, which in the late 60s, Aretha Franklin had a big hit with a song called Chain of Fools. Chain of Fools. Guitar player on that was a guy named Joe South. That was also the rest of the musicians are all the Muscle Shoals guys playing on that record. But Joe South tuned his guitar way down to get it to sound like Pop Staples, you know. And Pop's favorite Jazz Masters. He also played Telecasters and Jaguars. He had a really funky sounding Jazz Master that had a weird pickup in it that made it kind of out of phase. So I'm actually playing out of phase here, kind of assimilating. He also used a capo a lot, which, you know, I haven't talked really about that, but even the introduction of using capos was kind of, it was slow. You know, bluegrassers used them first. You know, Delta blues guys, some of them used them. But guys like Glenn Campbell, when he was in the Wrecking Crew, recording and playing guitar on Beach Boy Records and Frank Sinatra Records and Jan and Dean Records and all that kind of stuff. Him and a couple of guys here in Nashville started moving capos around and playing in different registers, and that's become something that's a big part of the recording process when it comes to layering guitars. Pops always had one, and he used these old style, I'm using this for a purpose because these old ones have this kind of dead sound that like when you use a new one, they kind of, the strings ring a little better, which most people would want, for that kind of sound, yeah, man, a good old $8 vintage capo. You know, I'm a geek, man. So at any rate, you know, Pops was a really big influence on just people in general. People like Curtis Mayfield, people like Jimi Hendrix. You know, even the Stones. This may be the last time. I don't have the right guitar on, but the... I can't play it because I don't have the right guitar on, but they covered that because the Staple Singers did it first in the 50s. Anyway, Pops is great. I love him a lot. So I'll do a Staple Singer song here.
In the water.
You pops, hope you're all right, hope you ain't too mad at us. So anyway, y'all with me? I'm having a good time talking about stuff I love. Oh man. So next guy I want to talk about, I talked about a little bit in the very first episode, but I'm gonna give him a proper, oh, before I move on, sorry, here's a great record to listen to, Faith and Grace. My favorite thing, it's just got all the things you need to hear. The Staple Singers, lovely Mavis up front, Miss Yvonne. Man, it's good, man. Does you right. I love it. If we don't listen to some Staple Singers, my wife gets angry. We got to have a steady stream of Staple Singers in the house. So, the next guy is actually the reason I'm sitting here. And it's this cat right here, Mr. Steve Cropper. Steve the Colonel Cropper. Steve Cropper of Booker T and the MGs and Stax fame. This is a great photo of him in the original Stax studio, Studio A, in the old movie theater there in Memphis. Just looking cool. Who knows what they're working on, but it's a groovy thing. And I'm going to talk about Steve Cropper a little bit. So, when I was a little boy, one of the first things I had access to, I have a few older sisters, and my older sister Diane was living with us for a while, and she was really into old Saturday Night Live. So not only would we watch Saturday Night Live at the time, in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, but we would, all the movies that were associated, so Animal House and Caddyshack and the Vacation movies, and most importantly, the Blues Brother movie. And growing up in Chicago, it's really cool for me to watch that movie now, because Chicago still looked exactly like it looked in that movie when I was a boy. Growing up in the city, I was originally we lived on the corner of Armitage and Halstead, near Lakeview, on the north side, sort of near Wrigley Field. And everything depicted in that movie looked and felt like that when I was a kid. So it's real nostalgic for me. But I fell in love with music because of that movie. And in particular, John Lee Hooker, the famous scene from Maxwell Street, but also the great Steve Cropper. I like Matt Murphy too, don't get me wrong, but Cropper just, it did something for me. And so, you know, Elvis and Scotty Moore, these things happened around the same time for me. So Steve holds a very, very, very special place in my heart. And, you know, just like Heartbreak Hotel and some of the other Elvis stuff that I've talked about was some of the first stuff I ever learned. Also learning, like, from their version of Everybody Needs Somebody to Love, Solomon Burke, and of course Wilson Pickett also did it. But that from the movie. And then getting into them, getting into Booker T and the MGs and getting into Stax as a result of falling in love with that movie. Tunes like Time Is Tight, where he's playing, some people just play. But you gotta play the harmony on top. He's actually going. It's very approachable, but it's so beautiful. It's so simple. So that, and then my favorite is a Booker T and the MG song. What's it called? God, I can't remember the name of it. It goes like this. Is it'll come to me in like 20 minutes. I'm sure people are bootleg. There it is, bootleg. That's what it's called. I love that. It's always my favorite. And so, you know, Cropper, lots been written. Obviously, he's still around. I've met him, talked to him. you know, the backbone of the Stax family, Booker T and the MGs, and of course Stax was founded by Jim Stewart and Estelle Axton, who were family. They were brother and sister, and started the company and moved into the little movie theater on Macklemore Avenue. And one of the first big hits was, of course, you know, Green Onions, you know. So the solo, and I talked about this in the first episode, but the solo, that killed me too. But anyway, that was one of the first big hits for Stax. And of course, they ended up signing a very young, unknown Otis Redding, as well as local talent from there in Memphis, people like Rufus Thomas and his daughter Carla, and local people like Isaac Hayes and William Bell, who I'm a huge fan of. But then, when they signed their distribution deal with Atlantic in New York, Jerry Wexler, they started making these incredible records for Sam and Dave, which of course, you know, Steve Cropper's most famous thing, you know. Soul Man, that's in the original, it was in G. The Blues Brothers, I think, did it in E. Did it in E, so I learned it in E first, but you know that. Cropper's use of the major third. It's a very Cropper sounding thing. Of course, people like Bobby Womack and Reggie Young did stuff like it. Cropper was a little grittier, a little rawer, not as refined. That's one of my favorite, that part, just the rhythm part on the verse of Soul Man. Because you think, you know, like what you could have played, you know. Do like Jimmy Johnson was doing in Muscle Shoals and just kind of chank through it, like, you know, boom. But it's like, here comes Cropper, you know, with this thing that completely fit with all the other parts, and it's just such a, this beautiful. Using the palm of his hand as a mute, so there's more percussion in the way he was playing, you know. And also, I talked about on the first episode, so I won't. But you know, his answer lines to the song "Sitting on the Dock of the Bay." It's a real tragic story. If you've ever. If you're privy, if you're not, I'll tell the story right now. So, you know, Otis had been making records for Stax for years, for, you know, almost 5 years, I guess, I think, at the point with when he died in December of 67. And he'd had songs that were hits on the R&B charts, but he hadn't had that big crossover hit that, like, people like Wilson Pickett or Sam and Dave had. And he wrote Sitting on the Dock of the Bay and brought it back to Memphis and finished it with Cropper, because Cropper also, you know, wrote, he wrote Midnight Hour, he wrote 99 and a Half Won't Do, he wrote Knock on Wood. I mean, just incredible. I mean, the songs this guy wrote with these artists. And he was a go-getter. People that I know that were around, you know, it's like Cropper was keen to go hang out with them at the Lorraine Motel there in Memphis, where everybody used to stay, which incidentally is also where Martin Luther King was assassinated. He used to go to the Lorraine and sit with them and write, you know, when other guys would go play in nightclubs or go on a date or go sleep or something, you know. Cropper was a go-getter who, you know, he started as the guy who mopped up, you know, who like, you know, he was like the janitor of Stax, and he worked his way into obviously being a first-rate picker, writer, arranger, producer, engineer. but one thing I do want to say about that I've learned, I actually learned sitting having breakfast with Steve Jordan one time, the great drummer, was the importance of this man right here, Al Jackson Jr., the great drummer of Booker T and the MGs, and also later, you've heard me talk about Willie Mitchell and all the Al Green records and all the records from High Records in the 70s, Ann Peebles and Syl Johnson, and Al Jackson, by all accounts, really was kind of the leader of the MGs. He was a natural leader. And there are many cases where, you know, Cropper is given credit, maybe as a producer or something like that, and Al is not given proper due. Essentially, you know, what was conveyed to me was that when they would record something, so you'd have Booker T and the MGs, you'd have the artist, and you'd have the Memphis Horns, Wayne Jackson, Andrew Love, and maybe you might have Isaac Hayes or David Porter, who maybe wrote the song, or maybe we're going to write the horn arrangement, or maybe we're going to help, maybe we're going to play, if Booker was on the organ, maybe Isaac would play piano, because that's another thing, Isaac, as well as being a staff writer, this is obviously before his huge success as an artist. You know, he played piano on a lot. Actually, he played on Bootleg, if I'm not mistaken. Played the organ. But they'd work up an arrangement of something, and then they'd go to cut it. And what they said to me was that, you know, or what Steve said to me is that, like, Duck and Booker were like, man, we'd cut something and, like, everybody's eyes would look at Al Jackson. Like, was that the take, you know? And Al was a big, 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 big force. He was a lot more than a drummer. And I love him a lot. And it's important to remember. So with Cropper, obviously, he went on to be a first-rate producer, producing a lot of stuff out in California after the Stax days. But his economy of notes and his use of double stops. So anyway, I started telling a story and then I stopped telling it. So I apologize, folks. So sitting on the dock of the bay, he was writing it, and so he brought it back for Cropper to finish, and then they cut the basic track, and the basic track, Steve was playing acoustic guitar, and Otis only knew how to play guitar tuned to open E, so he would just move his first finger around. That's why there's no minor chords in any of Otis's songs. So Steve recorded the track playing acoustic guitar, and when Otis's plane went down, they said, we need that record, we need to rush it right out. And they hadn't even retrieved his body yet. I know that's a grisly detail, but they hadn't even retrieved his body yet. And Steve had to go in and overdub his electric guitar you know, one of his best friends of his whole life was dead, and he had to go in and play. And he went in and played one of the most beautiful things that I think anyone's ever played, the That going into the bridge there, but that just that so perfect. It's just amazing, and the fact that he did it in the circumstances that he was in at the moment is just even more amazing to me. So I'm going to try and play something. The other thing that he was really good at was for the slow, sort of gospel-y kind of sounds, doing the... butterfly playing. It's very cropper. So I'm going to try and do something like that now. See if this is a good idea or a bad idea. We're about to find out. I've been loving you too long to stop now. Become a habit to me. I've been loving you too long to stop now. Scared. So anyway, Steve Cropper, as important as it comes, a bedrock player, and I certainly wouldn't be here if it weren't for him. So God bless you. So, this next thing that I want to talk about is actually, it's two players, but it's a record in particular. And it's this record right here, the Electric Mud Record, Muddy's Electric Mud Record, which is an incredible record. And, you know, for those who aren't aware, you know, it's when the psychedelic movement was dominating the charts and Chess, was trying to market and marshal the sun, as it were, Marshall Chess, took it upon himself to do some things that might appeal to the younger market. And so this is Muddy playing psychedelic acid rock versions of some of his best known songs. And he wasn't particularly a big fan of it, but I freaking love this record for a lot of different reasons. And the two guitar players that are on it, well, there's actually three players, but there's two in particular that are influential to me. And the first is this guy. This is Phil Upchurch, who I already mentioned. He's actually playing bass on one of the records of this week. Phil Upchurch, also found out just recently that he actually is the guy who's playing bass on Curtis Mayfield's first solo record, Curtis. So Move On Up and If There's a Hell Below, We're All Gonna Go. That's this guy playing bass. But he was a great guitarist and obviously became later on a well-known jazz guitarist. I first became aware of him because there's a great record that I'm sure I'll talk about on a future episode called Donny Hathaway Live, that is probably, you know, every great musician I've ever known has that on his list of Desert Island records. Phil Upchurch is on one side of it playing guitar and Cornell Dupree is on the other side. So anyway, Phil Upchurch is playing guitar on Electric Mud, and also this guy right here, this guy, his name is Pete Cosey, and he was the guitar player for Miles Davis in the 70s. So all the freak out fuzz and wah-wah and weird tape delay effects and flangers and all this kind of stuff and far out stuff, you know, Pete was kind of the guy, you know. But this record in particular is just very influential to me because of, it's just a lot, again, kind of like Hot Buttered Soul and some of those other sort of psychedelic R&B records. The mixing of psychedelic music with R&B and blues is something I really love. And, you know, they do the first song on the record is my favorite, which is their version of I Just Want to Make Love to You, you know. I'm love it. Pete Cosey. They also do a really slow version of Hoochie Coochie Man, and they do She's All Right. It's just so good. But it's all that fuzz, wah, crazy. The drum sound is amazing, and also it was a very, turns out apparently it was a very big influence on the Black Keys brothers. Even the covers are similar. A lot of the tones on the Black Keys record are kind of similar, what they were going for at the time, which I think is the best record the Black Keys have ever made. So anyway, I wanted to talk about that because this is just a record that's really important to me and something I've listened to a million times, and just that vibe, that psychedelic, weird, fizzy, fuzz, all that. And the last guy I want to talk about before I do something, before I wrap up with something else that people have requested, is I want to talk about another one of my favorites, this guy right here, that's Snuggie Otis. And Snuggie is criminally unknown by the masses. Snuggie made some incredible records, very ahead of his time records in the 70s. He was a prodigy who was gigging by the time he was, God, I think he was 6 or 7, and he would dress up in costumes to look older and go play in clubs and stuff. And he was discovered by the great Frank Zappa, who actually had him play bass on the Peaches of Regalia, song of Frank's. And Al Kooper, the great Al Kooper, who played organ on like Rolling Stone and went on to produce Lynyrd Skynyrd and played the fugal horn on the front of You Can't Always Get What You Want for the Rolling Stones. And that guy, that famous guy who did a million things, he kind of discovered him and made his first record with Al Kooper, which is a good record, but this record is my favorite, the Freedom Flight record, which had his biggest hit on it, Strawberry Letter 23, which you've probably heard on an oldie station or something. He went on to make another record that had a big hit on it, Inspiration Information, a couple years later, which is great. But Snuggie was kind of one of those Stevie Wonder kind of guys that, you know, he played all the instruments amazingly. And he was this funky guitar player, man. I mean, just funky as hell. And a big influence on me. Especially his slide playing. He's got a song on Freedom Flight called Sweet Thing, and it's just a funky track. It's Adam, who is in my band, Adam the Abershoff, the great drummer. It's his favorite track too, and he's very influenced by Earl Hooker, you know, that
Bye.
notice I'm using a metal slide. I don't normally, but that's kind of that sound. So I try and make it right. But he also had a really great, his funk playing and R&B playing are great. It's just a really great record. It's somebody I listen to a lot. He's kind of similar because I feel like a lot of my influences were his influences, even though he's a lot older than me. So I just, when I listen to him, I understand, you know, where his references are coming from. He definitely was he liked Magic Sam, you know, he liked B.B. King, all the other people I've talked about. I'll put that record up one more time. Go check it out. And by popular request, so at the end of the show, if you've made it this far. Oh, and by the way, I haven't put this up yet, but put that right there. Obviously, if anybody wants to throw anything in the tip jug, I really appreciate it. Thank you very kindly for all the kindness you guys have been. I really, really appreciate it. It's very heartwarming. So a lot of people have asked me about bass. So to close out this episode, I'll talk a little bit about bass. I love playing bass. This is my late 70s Hondo that the great Don Kelly gave me. And it's, you know, I like a lot of the people that played on all these records that I've been talking about. I played bass on some of my records and some stuff for other people and some of the scoring work and other stuff that I'm doing right now. And the last couple of funk instrumentals that we've posted, when I say we, I mean me and Adam, I'm playing bass on those. But, you know, guys like Duck Dunn, you know, who was in Booker T and the MGs, you know, because I just like playing. I like playing bass. Fred Thomas, who played with James Brown, is a big influence. Obviously, Jamerson. I can't play like Jamerson. I mean, you know. I can't play like Jamerson. That's all I got. The more simplistic sort of root funky players, Duck Dunn probably is my favorite. But also guys like Willie Weeks and David Hood, who I mentioned, you know. I use my thumb a lot. I like the way it sounds and the way it feels. And also a guy named Keith Ferguson, who was the original bass player in the Fabulous Thunderbirds for, like, playing blues. Because, like, for example, like, if a guitar player, like, in a shuffle in B, if a guitar player is playing, you know, a lot of bass players will find the need to play exactly what they're playing. And a guy like Keith Ferguson played something like this, you know. So anyway, just using space and not being overly syncopated, that's what I like. I've got old Labellas. They've been on this thing for a long time, Labella flat wound strings, and I've got it foamed up. And I like the covers because they look cool, but also because they actually change the way it sounds a little bit, and I like what it does to the sound. And also, I like the sound of this spot the most, and so it kind of forced, if this isn't here, I kind of tend to play over the pickup more. And I, Jamerson had his on, and it's just really round up here. I'm actually a bigger fan of drums and bass than I am of guitar, believe it or not. Adam will back me up on that. So at any rate, I really hope that everybody is doing okay out there. I'm trying my best to try and shave the time of these back just slightly, because there's a couple that have gone quite long. But I'm just trying to pass on some information, pass on some tips, and hopefully entertain you some too, and share something with you out there. I really appreciate you taking the time to join me, and it means a lot. And until next time, I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful night, and a great weekend. And thank you once again for joining me here on Greasy Time. And I will see you next week. Same bat time, same bat channel. So may the force be with you, always.